He's a pastor, author, and filmmaker. He's the bishop of the Potter's House in Dallas, Texas. His sermons are shown on the Trinity Broadcasting Channel, BET, and Daystar Television Network. His festival, MegaFest, has over 300,000 people attending it. This is T.D. Jakes' 5 Words of Wisdom.
Enjoy the journey, not the destination. A lot of us delay our happiness. When I get to this level, when I get my degree, when I get the kids, when I get married, I'm going to be happy. Enjoy the journey. Enjoy the whole step, the whole process. Every day that you get up to strive for whatever it is you're after. You know, I'm a goal-oriented guy.
Yeah, absolutely.
But you don't celebrate when you get to the finish line. Celebrate all along the way. Celebrate all along the way. Yeah. I said, many times we are pushed into functioning in an area that is not our highest and best use because somebody needed us to be something that we were not created to be.
That's what I was saying.
I got you.
That's exactly what I was talking about.
See what I'm saying?
You also say that people confuse, this happens all the time. Anybody who can sing just a little bit or they can write a piece of a poem, they think they're supposed to be Maya Angelou
all of a
sudden. And you say people confuse talent with purpose.
Yes, because so many times you have a modicum of talent in an area, maybe just enough talent to appreciate people who are really called to that area. It doesn't mean that you need to necessarily go out and do that thing. You must understand that the purpose is the underlying chemistry that makes you live your life. It may not be, you may not have a strong talent. Let me give an example because I'm messing mine up. Let me give you an example. I have talent as a musician. I can play the piano. Not well enough to be maestro, but I have a modicum of talent in that area, but that was not my purpose. But many, many times we start working in an area that we have talent, but it's not our purpose. I tell my kids this, you may start out doing something that is not the thing you were created to do. It may only be the thing that leads to the thing you were created to do. You understand what I'm saying?
I gotcha.
So you can't, don't stop at where you are as if it were the destination, when in fact, in reality, it may be the transportation that brings you into that thing you were created to do. My challenge in our generation is that gradually through entertainment, through television, through media, through every way possible, we are living in a generation of the dumbing down of ideas. Because we have traded effectiveness for busyness. Statistics say, yeah, somebody ought to clap on that. We are busier than any other generation we have seen in the last 300 to 400 years. We are so busy. We are busier than a one-armed wallpaper hanger. We're just busy. You'll get it later. Don't worry about it. It'll hit you in a minute. We are just as busy as we can be, and we think because we're busy, we're effective. But I want you to challenge your schedule for a minute and ask yourself, are you really being effective, or is your life cluttered with all kinds of stuff that demands you and drains you and taxes you and stops you from being your highest and best self? And are you substituting busyness and all the chaos that goes along with busyness from being effective? Let me tell you, a bunch of scientists got together and they began to do some research, and they began to determine that 80% of the things we do are busy things that we do in an area that is not effective, that the average person only spends 20% of their time doing the thing that they are really gifted at, created at, passionate about, excited to do, and the rest of it is all the dismal, dumb stuff that we all have to do in order to survive. Just crazy stuff that we're doing. Wonder what would happen if we would go from doing 80% of things that are busy but not effective and 20% of the things that are really effective, if we would switch those numbers around and only give 20% of our time to the things that we have to do and 80% of our time to the thing that we were created to do. Wonder what would happen to your life. Now think about it a minute. There's a lot of things you could take from me and I could make it. You could take my suit. I got another one. You could take my car. I could get another one. You could take my house. I could get another house. But when you take my time, You have taken something from me that is totally irreplaceable. We take all kind of classes from money management. We know how to manage our money. We know how to repair our houses. We're working on our hair and our bodies and all of this kind of stuff. We do everything except the most important thing is to value our time. It takes time to be creative. You were meant to be creative. You were created in the likeness and the image of a creator, and in that likeness and in that image, you have creativity. If you had time, you would be creative. But in the absence of time and with busyness and clutter and the phone ring, beep, 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 y'all got music playing on your phone, all kinds of stuff. And no matter what kind of song you put on it, after a while, you hate to hear it, because every time you hear that sound, you know it's somebody else wanting something else from you that's taking you away from what you are gifted and creative to do. This is a life class. That means that we have an opportunity to learn how to maximize our lives. Think of the things that you're doing that somebody else could be doing. And think of yourself as a precious commodity that you are going to reserve your energy for your highest and best use. The first thing we teach people that understand their significance, if you are doing anything that somebody else in your life could do, you are not reserving yourself for your highest and best use. We are not using our life, our time, our energy for our highest and best use. And something in the back of this brain back here is going, ding, 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 ding. You're missing it. You're missing your life, your purpose, your passion, your excitement, your enthusiasm. And through these classes, what we want to do is shake you and rattle you and stir you up to understand that every moment is a gift, every second is a gift, every thought is a gift, every idea is a gift, every opportunity is a gift, everybody you meet is a gift. You are gifted with opportunities, and I want to show you how to begin to maximize what you've got.
Well, I've seen you do 3 sermons, actually. You started out the first of the year, and then you followed up the next Sunday, and then the next Sunday with Living on Purpose. And I was so inspired by those. I wanted to really stimulate the rest of our viewers in order to get their lives on track on purpose. And one of the things that I think often happens is that people think that when you say find your purpose, that it has to be some big thing.
Right.
That unless it's some, like people, you know, we went out and interviewed them. They're like, oh, I don't know what my purpose is. Aren't you, no matter where you are in the space you're in right now,
right,
have the ability to shift, to make that shift?
You do have that ability to shift. And I think that there's a certain level of maturity that has to come, and it comes to different people at different ages. It doesn't mean that everybody's supposed to run the country or find some new fuel for us to expunge, but it does mean that you are significant. And whether it is a big thing or a little thing, if it brings you gratification, if it brings you fulfillment, if it seems to fit the complexity of your life, because we are very complex people. We are not one-dimensional people. We have assets and liabilities. We have things that we love about ourselves and things that we don't, but all of it fits, not just the good of us.
Yeah.
Even the things that we have labeled as our lesser strengths still fit within the continuity of a purpose. You weren't supposed to be taller. You weren't supposed to be able to sing. If you don't sing, you weren't supposed to. Understanding that you don't spend your life trying to be what you are not.
Mm-hmm.
See,
mm-hmm.
That's half the battle right
but,
there.
But, you know, one of the other things that I love that you said is that, you know, because people think I often, well, that's for those people over there, or when I get myself together, I'm going to live on purpose.
Right.
But you say it is possible wherever you are right now, Facebook, anywhere in the world watching us, that even if you're in the middle of a disaster,
right,
you can use that disaster for direction.
Absolutely, because it is through the disaster, it is through the adversity that our strength is developed. If everything went the way you wanted it to go, you wouldn't have anything to exercise by. It's a gymnasium of life where you get the workout, the resistance, and you find out things about yourself that you didn't know. I'm stronger than I thought I was. I'm tougher than what I thought I was. I'm more resilient than I thought I was. And that self-respect stops you from being at the mercy of other people to validate you, to make you feel
feel good about who you are.
You have to fix the mind before you can bestow the blessing, because until they get their mind right, everything you invest in them is going to leak out of the crevices of a mind that refuses to change. Look at your neighbor and ask him, do you have a mind to change? Wait for an answer. If they said no, drag them to the altar. Tell them they got till midnight to get that fix. They've got till midnight to dump out all jealousy, all pettiness, all unforgiveness, all strife, all malice, all confusion, all blaming other people for your mistake. You got till midnight to get rid of every poison that's hindering you, every inflexibility that's stopping you from what God is about to pour into your life. Woe be unto you if you go into another year and waste another year with the old mentality while somebody's in the hospital begging God for the opportunity that you have right now. You better step into this moment. Lay your hands on your head and say, give me a new mind. Give me a new mind means give me a new perspective. Give me a new perspective. Give me a new way of looking at my situation. Give me a new way of looking at my circumstances. Get my mind ready for this year, because when I get this year, there's going to be blessings. There's going to be miracles. There's going to be opportunities. Oh, yes, it's going to be some struggles. It's going to be some challenges. It's going to be some tests. But even the struggles are an opportunity for me to show off the victory if my mind can handle the change. Do you have the mindset to be blessed? You have to decide to be blessed. You have to decide. You know what? This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad. I will rejoice. I, as an act of my will, I've decided I'm going to rejoice. I made up my mind. I'm going to be happy. I made up my mind. I'm going to enjoy. I'm as healthy as I'm going to be. I'm as young as I'm ever going to be. I can't get any younger. I can't roll the clock back. With what I got left, I'm going to maximize this. I will rejoice. See, that's getting on somebody's nerves right now, because that old mind can't rejoice. No, not me. I can't rejoice. I'm still angry. I'm not going to rejoice till they apologize. I'm not going to rejoice until he leaves that other woman. I'm not going to rejoice until my children appreciate me. You are wasting time. You have to let the past go and step over into the future and say, I will rejoice. Tell three people and tell them, there's some things I'm not taking with me in the new year. Everything that's inflexible and everything that's not ready and everything that's backwards and everything that's negative and everything that's condescending and everything that's carnal and everything that's holding me back, I refuse to take it over into another year and waste another new year with an old mind. The devil is a lie. Am I preaching right tonight? Paul said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Then he says, and be not conformed, or in other words, to this world. Don't shape yourself around the comings and goings of this world. Don't shape your opinions and your attitudes around circumstances that you cannot change. Don't build your identity around worldliness. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. The word transform comes from the Greek word metamorpho, where we get metamorphosis. He said, you can go through a metamorphosis, a complete transformation, not because it's January 1, but by the renewing. Woo. If you knew what I dropped on you just there, you'd just be shouting right now. Dorothy, I want to tell you, you could have been home a long time ago. As soon as you decide to stop looking for answers in other people and miracles somewhere down the yellow brick road and click the heel of your mind and set your affections on things that are above, you could have been free years ago. The most powerful tool that you have right now in your life, in your body, is your mind. And your mind is so strong and so powerful that the Bible said, it is with the mind that we serve the Lord. Say that with me. It is with the mind that we serve the Lord. That's why the enemy fights you in your mind. He fights you in your mind. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. The devil doesn't have to tie you up for you to be bound. He just has to tie up your head with stress, with worry, with aggravation, with low self-esteem, with pettiness, with anger, with hostility, with rebellion, and he can make you physically sick because your mind is sick. But somebody in here tonight is about to get a miracle in your head. Look at your neighbor and say, you don't have to get out of trouble. Tell him, you don't have to get out of trouble before midnight. You just have to get your mind out of trouble. If you can get your mind out, you can get your money out. You can get your family out. You can get your job out. You can get your career out. You can get your health out. You can get your prosperity out. If you can get your mind out, no devil in hell, no weapon formed against you, no enemy that hates you, no witch that hexes you can stop you from being free. If you can get your mind out, grab yourself by the head and say, we're coming out of this. Slap somebody and say, I'm coming out head first. Yeah. Yeah, I'm coming out head first. I'm going to get my head out. I'm going to get my thinking out. I'm going to get my mentality out. I'm coming out head first. And when my head comes, everything that's connected to the head is going to have to come out too. I'm getting my head. Transformed by the renewing of your mind, not by the clock striking 12, but by the renewing of your mind. I'm going to tell you why watch night is going to have meaning to you. Not because it's midnight, but because some of you have gone through so much hell last year that the trouble you went through forced you that you know you can't go into the future thinking like you were thinking and feeling like you were feeling. You are forced to the point that you have got to get your head out first and everything else is going to follow. Who am I talking to tonight? Slap somebody and tell them I'm coming out head first.
Hey, if you liked this video, go ahead and hit that like button. If you're new to 517 Fitness, hit that subscribe button. And hey, take any of those words of wisdom and leave them in the comments down below. That way, we can start having a communication about it, but also by writing it, you'll remember it. God bless, finish strong, and I will see you in the next video.